So you're doing research, but do you know what you're looking for? Here are some tips for finding the sources that you actually need. Hey, so good to see you again. Today we're talking about research because even though I've whined about how research isn't technically writing, it is a big part of the writing process and it often gets lumped into writing classes. And because writing classes often have to pull a double shift, research can sometimes get explained in kind of a foggy way. At least I know it's never been my favorite thing to try to explain. See, the problem is that there are so many sources out there, and a lot of writing assignments just call for a certain number of sources. And as a result, I find a lot of papers that have the right number of sources, but they're just kind of there. Those sources aren't really doing anything useful. This video, then, is meant to help solve that problem. I've spent some time thinking about what I'm actually looking for when I'm looking for sources, and I want to share those insights with you. The goal is to help you to be more strategic about your research so that you can find better sources and use them to write better papers. More specifically, I want to talk about five types of sources that I'm generally looking for whenever I'm working on a research project, and about how each type can help you to strengthen your argument. Ready? Let's go. Now, I know I just recently said that it's practically impossible to prove anything, and I do stand by that, but the alliterative power of problem provers was just too hard to pass up. You do have to pay attention to branding, after all. But really, the point is that any research paper will need sources that help to establish the nature of the problem that you're writing about. Before you can do anything else, you need those sources to show that there actually is a problem. And you've heard people say, if it ain't broke, don't fix it, and that's exactly why you need these problem-proving sources. If your readers don't believe that there's a problem, it's not very likely that they'll care too much about your argument. So, for example, look for sources that will help you to explain why a university's recycling program is ineffective before you use sources to persuade them to change that program. Otherwise, they won't really feel like they have much of a reason to. The goal is to find sources that A, show that there is a problem, and B, show that other people think that it's a problem too. If you can help your readers to feel a sense of urgency, they'll be a lot more likely to listen to your argument and a lot less likely to think that you're just trying to make something out of nothing. In addition to establishing the problem, you'll also want to find sources that talk about what other people have done to address the issue. Not only will it reinforce for your reader that this is a problem they should care about, but it will also help them to see why they should be listening to your proposal specifically. At its most basic, you're trying to show that the problem still needs a solution. That means finding sources that explain why previous attempts have failed, or more likely, you could just find other people's proposals and critique them yourself. Either way, it's important to have sources that show your reader that the problem hasn't been solved yet, because nobody really needs to read your paper if somebody else has already solved the issue. So if lots of people have already tried to analyze a particular novel, be sure to find and include sources that explain why those other analyses have missed something important before you write your own. That way, your readers will see that what you have to say is necessary and useful. Now, in addition to using sources to show why previous attempts at solving the problem haven't quite been good enough, you'll also want to use sources that show why your approach is more likely to work. That is, you'll want to show how similar approaches have worked in the past. Really, you're building a case for your methodology or analytical framework or whatever it is that you're using to build your solution. And you want to do that so that your audience can see that you're building on past successes. If a particular approach has worked in the past, it makes sense that it could work again. For example, Wayne Booth, whom we've talked about on the show before, developed a method for evaluating the ethics of fiction, and I'm currently adapting that method in my own analysis of the ways that science communicators relate to their audiences. So I'm not critiquing Booth's work, instead I'm reapplying his method in a new context and using him as a source to justify my method for analyzing science communicators' work in the way that I am. And that shows my readers that I'm not just winging it, but that I'm using sound, tested methods to address a new kind of problem. Once you have sources that establish the problem, show your readers that it hasn't been solved yet, and justify your strategy for solving the problem, you're probably going to need sources that support your claims along the way. These are probably the kinds of sources that get talked about the most, and they're the kinds that back up the things that you say as you develop your actual argument. They can tell your readers why you stand where you stand, show them why what you're saying is true, or provide other kinds of supporting evidence. And it's generally pretty easy to find places in your paper where you need to include these kinds of sources. You can just look for spots where a reader might ask, "How do you know?" or "Who says?" Depending on the project, you may be able to deal with those kinds of questions with some high-quality explanation or reasoning, But in many cases, those kinds of reader concerns are easily addressed with a good source or two. Because that's what claim-supporting sources do. They show your readers how you know that what you're proposing will work, and they do the important job of showing your reader that it's not just you who thinks so. You see, there's rhetorical strength in numbers. If you have sources that show that other people agree with the claims that you're making, then you're going to look a lot less like a crazy person ranting into the void, and a lot more like a thoughtful, reasonable person with a solid plan. If there's one kind of source that I regularly hear about my students going out of their way to find, it's sources that present what they call the counterargument. Somewhere along the line, people get taught that they need to include sources that disagree with the argument that they're trying to make. Now, when they include those kinds of counterargument sources, they're doing something that in principle is pretty good, but it's clear that they're doing it for the wrong reasons. So let's all agree right now that you don't need to include sources that disagree with your argument in order to appear fair and non-biased. That's unnecessary and completely counterproductive. Taking a stand is not the same thing as being biased, and saying that the other side has good points too does not strengthen your argument, it only confuses your readers. Instead, you include sources that disagree with your argument so that you can respond to them and show your readers why your proposal is, in fact, a whole lot better. So you want to include counterarguments in order to counter them right back. If you know that people are going to attack your argument in a particular way, and you have sources to show it, and you can respond to and overcome those challenges, then you show people that you have thought about and addressed the potential weaknesses in your argument. In other words, don't just acknowledge your weaknesses, acknowledge them by dealing with them. That's why you include sources that disagree with your argument, and that's how you can use them to write even more persuasively. Research can be a challenging process, especially if you don't have a good strategy going into it. But as I've thought about the kinds of sources that I look for and use, these are the five main types. No doubt, there are other ways to use sources and even other ways to accomplish these five tasks. But in general, and for most academic arguments, these are the main types of sources that you'll want to keep in mind. So instead of just searching aimlessly for a minimum number of sources, conduct your research with purpose, looking for sources that establish the problem, critique previous solutions, justify your methods, support your claims, and give you a chance to respond to challenges. When you do, your research process will be more productive and your writing will end up being more effective. Now before we quit, I just want to say thank you for watching. It's always a delight to hear when one of these videos has helped someone, because that is after all why I'm doing this. So if there's anything else that you'd like to learn about writing, please let me know in the comments. Otherwise, happy researching, and I'll see you around.